Maxwell's theory was just a fanciful interpretation of Faraday's and Ampere's experiments. The theory of special relativity has been questioned as soon as Maxwell's electromagnetic theory was eliminated. The Michelson and Morley interferometer had detected speeds that can reach 9 km per second. Professor Allais has nullified the relativistic interpretation of Michelson and Morley's experiment. Miller's measurements highlighted the need for an aether to explain the correlations between the relative motions of the Moon, Earth, and Sun. Finally, Professor Celery took away all hope from relativists by demonstrating that the theory of special relativity can in no way explain Sagnac's experiment. As a consequence of Celery's paradox, there can be no relativistic metric of rotation around an axis. The theory of general relativity therefore cannot explain this experience either. Aether particles have an angular momentum. This angular moment explains the polarization of light. This same aether explains gravitation. An aether therefore fills space from the confines of the universe to the very interior of the atoms. It is made up of particles like all fluids. In this aether, the only possible explanation for the result of Professor Allais analyzes is that the aether has flows compatible both mainly with the rotation of the Earth around the Sun and with its own rotation around its axis. The aether must be dragged along with the Earth around the Sun. This drag negates the relative speed of Earth and aether. In order for there to be an effect of the Sun, the aether has to move towards the Sun, condenses in the Sun. There is no other way to explain the shifts measured at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. when the Michelson and Morley interferometer is in a plane containing the Sun and the Earth. This shift is slightly modified by the eccentricity of the Earth's trajectory. There is also a corrective effect in the Earth-Moon direction resulting from the condensation of aether in the Moon. Another corrective effect results from the rotation of the aether around the Earth. The Michelson and Morley interferometer is always in a horizontal plane, therefore perpendicular to the flow of condensation of aether in the Earth. This flow has no effect on the interferometer. Matter is practically empty. The nuclei occupy only the 10^100,000th part of the atoms. For simplicity, the frictions in the ether are neglected. It is a perfect fluid and therefore without fluid drag. It is the paradox of D'Alembert. But, it carries waves. It is also an ideal gas. However, there is a pressure drag in ideal gases. In fact, the speed of these ether currents adds to the speed of agitation of the ether particles, on the front surface of the atom nuclei, and subtracts at the back. There is thus an overpressure on one side, and a depression on the other, which add up since they concern the opposite surfaces of the atom nuclei. The condensation of aether in the Sun and the celestial bodies can only come from condensation in the atom nuclei, and probably in elementary particles. The aether is therefore animated by fluxes directed towards the stars. If the aether is incompressible, the speed of these flows is inversely proportional to the square of the distance to the stars in which it condenses. The flow of aether condensation is proportional to the outer surface of the atomic nuclei. For it to be proportional to their mass, it is only necessary that the atom nuclei are bubbles and not solid balls. It would also be necessary for the thickness of these bubbles to be the same for all the atoms. This is not exactly the case. The thickness varies very slightly. This explains the mass defect, the order of magnitude of which is 10^-24 grams. It is also the order of magnitude of the difference between the inert mass and the heavy mass. The drag of the ether is proportional to the apparent surface of the nuclei of atoms. However, the mass of the nucleus is proportional to their apparent surface. The drag of condensation fluxes from the ether is therefore proportional to the mass of the nuclei of atoms. This is exactly Newton's law. But things get more complicated, because ether drag also occurs when nuclei move through ether. The planets should collapse on the Sun. Hamilton's principle saves the day. The flow of an ideal gas towards a well is not stable. It rotates. The Hamilton's principle gives the shape of the whirlpool that inevitably forms. This is evident in water and air, but also applies to ether. The stars are therefore surrounded by whirlpools. We obviously think of Descartes. But here the whirlpools have a cause, the condensation of ether in matter. The whirlpool of the Sun drags the planets in rotation. The tangential speed of this whirlpool must therefore be proportional to the inverse of the square root of the distance to the Sun. Unfortunately, these whirlpools in perfect fluids have a tangential velocity proportional to the inverse of the distance to the center of the whirlpool. This result is taken from the Lagrange equation, the energy equation. But then there is a solution. Ether particles are animated not only by linear Brownian motion, but also by angular momentum. The principle of equipartition of energy exactly doubles the energy term in the Lagrange equation. The solution is then exactly a tangential speed proportional to the inverse of the square root of the distance to the center of the star. These were the velocities of the ether currents. The motions of the stars themselves are obtained by applying Kepler's laws. The planets have no drag in their rotation around the Sun, because the ether rotates with them. Whirlpools are the stable form of flows towards a well in application of Hamilton's principle. In application of Poincaré's theorem, the whirlpool is concentrated in a plane which is the main plane of galaxies and the equatorial plane of stars and planets. On each side of this equatorial whirlpool, the ether also condenses so that whirlpools must appear and so on up to the poles. The zones thus formed are separated by eddy cones, giving the zones alternating reverse rotations. This explains the zonal appearance of the planets. The ether rotates the gases that surround the planets. This is the case for Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. The zones formed by these gases themselves cause gas whirlpools by friction at their interfaces, as can be seen up to the pole of Jupiter. Earth's ocean currents are also clearly zonal in nature. The phenomenon is also indisputable for terrestrial winds, although it is less obvious. The rotation of the Sun on itself is essentially zonal. Moreover, the small inclinations of the trajectories of comets relative to the equatorial plane of the Sun have a clearly zonal distribution. The rotational electric field of the Maxwell-Faraday equation imagined by Maxwell has no effect on the electron beams. This equation does not apply in a vacuum, and therefore it cannot in any way represent the propagation of a wave in a vacuum. The Maxwell-Hertz equation is a pure postulate of Maxwell without any experimental justification. Without the Maxwell-Faraday equation, it makes no sense. Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic waves is an assumption without any basis. Maxwell's theory, however, provided a solution to the transverse nature of light. On the other hand, its corpuscular nature was incompatible with an ether. It was necessary to invent the double nature of light, wave and particle. Maxwell's double failure brings up the problem of the nature of light. The failure of Maxwell's theory brought relativity in its wake. Maxwell's theory was the only justification for Einstein's theory after the relativistic interpretation of the Michelson and Morley experiment was challenged by Professor Allais. The Michelson and Morley interferometer had detected speeds that can reach 9 km per second. Miller's measurements had highlighted the need for an aether to explain the correlations between the relative motions of the Moon, Earth, and Sun. An aether therefore fills space from the confines of the universe to the very interior of the atoms. It is made up of particles like all fluids. These particles of the aether move in all directions. And they propagate waves like all fluids. The speed of these waves in the aether is the quadratic mean of the speeds of agitation of the particles of the aether. Unlike corpuscles, waves in media can split into two wave trains and interfere. We also get interference with electrons, carbon-60 molecules, and even with large organic molecules. Unlike the waves generated here in the water, these electrons and molecules move at very low speeds compared to the celerity of light. As a result, the waves they form as they move through the ether precede them. They interfere and cause a distribution of these elements in the space located after the slits. The high-pressure areas push the electrons, atoms, or molecules towards the low pressures which remain aligned in the direction of the bands which form on the receiving device. There is therefore no need for presence probabilities. Whereas, in air and water, the complex shape of molecules cancels their angular momentum when they collide, particles in ether, simple spheres, can have an angular momentum. The introduction of the angular momentum of the ether particles has an interesting consequence. When two of these particles collide, the momentum is transmitted according to Descartes' laws. This transmission occurs by elastic deformation of the ether particles. The elastic deformation of the ether particles prevents the sliding of the particles one over the other as a result of the flattening of the parts in contact. During the oscillations of the electrons, they transmit their momentum to the particles of the ether, but also their angular momentum. The angular moments can only be transmitted transversely. This feature explains the transverse nature of light. Each wave train is therefore polarized in the orientation of the angular momentum of the emitting electrons. The Orsay experiment, also known as the aspect experiment, therefore poses no problem. The state of polarization is obviously the same for the two symmetrical wave trains emitted by the vibrations of the electrons. There is no need for quantum entanglement. One can observe the polarization of the blue of the sky in the opposite direction to the sun and the double polarization of the K layer of the sun with this instrumented diaphragm tube. If in viscous fluids, waves propagate by dispersing, the same is not true in a medium made up of particles of simple shapes. In water, the dispersion of waves results from the complex shape of the molecules. In the air, the sound is already much more directional. With a megaphone, the sound waves may be concentrated. In the ether, the vibrations of an electron cause two symmetrical wave trains whose transverse surfaces remain invariable over very large distances if the particles of the ether are very regular spheres. In these conditions, they do not drag their neighbors. Such wave trains can therefore have effects analogous to a corpuscle. This is the case of the photoelectric effect. Gravitational waves travel at the speed of light. These waves are also waves of the ether. They are emitted by the movements of the stars at extremely low frequencies below 300 Hz at the same time as light waves which exceed frequencies of 4 to the 14 Hz. The ether has a pressure like all fluids. This pressure is exerted on the nuclei of the atoms and maintains their cohesion. A moving particle in this fluid is subject to a pressure drag. Its lifespan is therefore extended if it is unstable. An atom that moves very quickly in ether is flattened, so it has a modified wavelength in addition to the Doppler effect. Electrons cannot rotate around the nuclei of atoms without their drag in the ether causing them to fall onto the nucleus. In reality, electrons make quantized jumps above the nucleus of atoms. After the ejection of an electron, the nucleus can eject another electron, but with a different energy, since its mass has changed. This explains the Pauli exclusion principle. The rotation of the perfect fluids in the whirlpool very exactly compensates the rotation on themselves of the fluid particles. This flow is irrotational. The same is not true in the ether. The angular kinetic energy of the ether particles doubles the energy term. The rotation of the vortices requires an input of angular kinetic energy. It can only come from the angular kinetic energy of the particles of ether. The rotation of the whirlpool absorbs part of the angular kinetic energy of the particles of the ether. So that, for example, near the sun where the speed of rotation is very high, the law of tangential velocities is no longer exactly the inverse of the square root of the distance. A similar phenomenon occurs for galaxies that do not respect this law either. Their size leads to a very significant decrease in the angular kinetic energy available when approaching their eye. The tangential speed goes from 1 over square root of r to 1 over r according to the red curve. It varies very little over a long distance. There is no need for dark matter. When the rotation of the whirlpool is fast enough, a hole appears in the center. This is the case in water as well as in the atmosphere. The central part of a cyclone is free of clouds, drops of water. You can see it very clearly in the photos taken from space. It is the same with the ether filling the cosmos. The ether condenses in the stars of the galaxies. Swirls must therefore. Galaxies are therefore large whirlpools dragging stars around their eye. And in the center of the galactic whirlpool, a hole can appear if the rotational speed of the whirlpool is large enough. This hole is not free of ether just as a cyclone in the atmosphere is not free of air. The galaxy hole is free of matter, free of atoms, so it appears to be black because there is no emission of light when there are no atoms. It's a black hole. The result is that it could happen that a galaxy located far beyond a black hole could be observed inside the black hole. The ether particles condense into the nuclei of atoms. The nuclei of atoms therefore grow over time. Observed at galactic distances, they must therefore appear to us with a shifted spectrum. There is no need to assume that galaxies are moving away from us to explain the Hubble effect. There is no Big Bang. The planets grow progressively larger due to the enlargement of the nuclei of the atoms, but the Earth has a greater density in the center than on the surface. The central part must therefore grow faster and the surface must become distended. It distends mainly in the thinnest areas, at the bottom of the oceans. In addition, there are regular magma eruptions which lower the internal pressure of the Earth. This explains the great mountain ranges that arose from the bottom of ancient seas, volcanoes, and earthquakes.